Good day, students. I hope you are doing fine. Continue to keep to the rules of COVID-19 and stay safe. And my name is Isurekila Tongwada. I will be taking you in geography. The topic we are about to consider this day is weather and climate. Now we shall begin by looking at the meaning of weather and climate, what weather and climate means. And then we shall look at the major elements of weather and climate, then move to the importance of weather studies, and then lastly we shall see the factors influencing weather and climate. So what do we mean by weather? Now the word weather means the condition of the atmosphere at a particular time and place. For example, hot, cold, cloudy, etc. So when we say it is hot or it is cold or cloudy, we are saying something about the condition of the atmosphere at a given time. And that is what weather is. Climate, on the other hand, means the average weather condition of a place over a long period of time, usually between 30 to 35 years. So if you want to know the climatic type of an area, what you do is to keep the records of weather over a number of years, of between 30 to 35 years. And at the end of these years, you calculate the average, and the average will now give you the climatic type of a particular area. Now, what are the elements of weather and climate? The elements include, one, we have rainfall. And rainfall can be measured by using a rain gauge. Secondly, we have temperature. Temperature can also be determined with a thermometer. The third one is atmospheric pressure. This can be measured with a barometer. The fourth one is humidity. Humidity can be determined by the use of a hygrometer. And then wind has direction and it has speed. You can measure wind direction by using a wind vane. And you can equally measure wind speed by using an anemometer. Now the last major element, the last element of weather and climate is sunshine. And this can be measured by the use of what we call a sundial. We shall consider the importance of studying weather and climate. Why is it important for us to have a knowledge of weather and climate? Now we all know that our life rallies around weather and climate. Our daily life rallies around weather and climate. And that is why it is very important for us to have a knowledge of it. Now the first major reason why we study weather and climate is because it affects our way of life, such as how we dress, what we eat, the type of house that we live in. So therefore, we need to know so that we can follow the condition of the weather at a given time. For example, those people that are found in the polar regions of the world, polar regions are areas of cold temperature. Normally, they dress based on the condition of the atmosphere in their area. And those people that are found in the tropical regions of the world equally dress based on the type of weather that they are found in. And that is why the knowledge of weather and climate is very, very important. Now, the second reason why we study weather and climate is for the safety of air travelers. We all know that visibility is very, very important. And that is why the aircraft need to be worn before they take off. The meteorologists, those that study weather and climate, they warn against any impending danger before the aircraft would take off. The third major reason for studying weather and climate is to determine the type of crops to be grown in a particular area. Now we all know that climate varies from one part of the world to another. For example, in Nigeria, the conditions from the northern parts of Nigeria to the southern parts of Nigeria varies greatly. The amount of rainfall received in the northern parts and the southern parts of Nigeria varies greatly. And that also affects the type of crops that are grown in these areas. And that is why it is very important for us to have a knowledge of it, so that we know the type of crops that can be grown in a particular area. The southern parts of Nigeria, being very close to the sea, experience much rainfall than the northern parts of Nigeria. And because of that, three crops are mostly grown in the southern parts of Nigeria than in the northern parts of Nigeria. And as you move across the country to the northern parts of Nigeria, you will discover that more of cereal crops are grown in the north, because the quantity of the rain is not as much as in the southern parts of Nigeria. And therefore, the study of weather and climate is very, very important, because it will help us to know the type of crop that can suit a particular environment or a particular area. The fourth major reason why we study weather and climate is to warn people against impending danger. Some of the danger could include floods, it could include drought, hurricanes, and so on and so forth. These are environmental hazards that could happen at any point in time. And therefore, the study of weather and climate helps in giving a full knowledge to people to avoid them being taken unaware. Now, through the study and through the records of weather and climate daily, people can be warned to vacate certain areas in case of any impending danger. The fifth major reason why we study weather and climate is for good organization of our programs. Programs such as games, ceremonies, and so on and so forth, they are best done when the weather is good for such programs. So a knowledge of weather and climate can help in the organization of such programs. And the last reason why we study weather and climate is for military operations. They also depend on weather conditions. Now, clarity of the weather will also help in good operations. Now, the last thing we shall look at are the factors influencing weather and climate. The factors influencing weather and climate. And the first factor we shall consider is altitude. Now, what is altitude? Altitude simply means the height of a place above sea level. Now, in geography, we all know that temperature decreases with height. The higher you go, the cooler it becomes. For every 1,000 meters ascension you make upward into the atmosphere, there is a reduction in temperature of about 6.5 degrees Celsius. And that reduction in temperature is called the normal lapse rate. Now, that explains why areas that are found on higher altitude tend to experience a much more lower temperature. They experience a cooler temperature than areas that are found on the lowlands. On the lowlands, temperatures are higher than on the highlands. Why? Because of the decrease in temperature. Now, this decrease in temperature is only found within the first layer of the atmosphere. And that first layer is called the troposphere. And all the activities that result to our weather and climate takes place within the troposphere. By the time you move outside of the troposphere into the second layer of the atmosphere, you discover that a different thing happens entirely. So, altitude is very, very important in the aspect of weather and climate, because it determines how moist an area is. It also determines how hot an area is, and it can also determine how cold an area is. Areas that are found on the lowlands are hotter than areas that are found on the highlands, because the higher you go, the cooler it becomes. Just like I said from the beginning, there is a decrease in temperature as you move upwards within the troposphere. Now, the second factor again is distance from the sea. Now, when we talk of distance from the sea, we are talking about how close you are to the sea or how far away you are from the sea. Now, areas that are found closer to the sea, like Nigeria, we have the southern parts of Nigeria located much more closer to the sea. Places like Lagos, places like Port Harcourt, delta and so on and so forth, are found closely, closer to the sea than those areas that are found in the northern parts of Nigeria, like Sokoto, like Maiduguri, and so on and so forth. Now, those areas in the north are bordered by the Sahara Desert. So the influence of the Sahara Desert is much more in the north than in the south. And those areas that are found in the south, they have the advantage of the sea very close to them. And so those areas tend to experience much moisture than those areas that are found far away from the sea. So the closer an area is to the sea, the much moisture that that area will experience. And the further away an area is from the sea, the less moisture that that area will experience. The third major factor that we have here is latitude. Now, when we talk of latitude here, we are talking about the latitudinal location of an area in respect to the equator, which is the central latitude line that divides the earth or the globe into two equal parts. Now, different areas are located on different parts of the world. Areas that are situated around the equatorial region tend to experience a much more higher temperature. Why? Because of their closeness to the equator. Now, around the equatorial areas, there is a direct heating, concentration of the heat of the sun, and therefore making those areas to experience a much more higher temperature. But away from the equatorial areas, if you move away from the equatorial areas, the equator is here, 0 degrees. When you move upwards to the poles here, we have the north poles there, and then we have the south pole here. The north pole is 90 degrees north, and the south pole is 90 degrees south. Now to the poles here, you discover that there is a decrease in temperature as you move away towards the poles, the north and the south poles. Now because of that, areas that are found around the poles here experience a much more lower temperature. Why? Because they are far away from the equator. And the heat of the sun dispersed around the poles, the north and the south poles. Whereas around the equator, I have said there is a concentration of the heat of the sun, therefore leading to higher temperature around this area, and making the waters around the equator to also be warmer than those that are found towards the poles. So the closer an area is to the equator, the more hotter that area is because of the concentration of the heat of the sun on those areas that are found around the equator. Whereas areas that are found far away from the equator, we say the heat of the sun do disperse, and so there is less heat to those areas compared to those areas that are around the equator. The next factor again that influences weather and climate is ocean currents. Now, what do we mean by ocean currents? Ocean currents here, we are talking about the large movement of surface water from one part of the ocean to another. Now, this large movement of water could be caused by the rotation of the earth, it could be caused by waves, and so on and so forth. Now, what we are saying is that based on the latitudinal location, again, just like I've explained earlier on, different places are situated in different parts of the globe. There are areas that are found closer to the equator, and there are those ones that are found further away. And I also explained earlier on that to the equatorial regions, the water bodies here are heated greatly by the intense heat, making the water to be hotter than, to be warmer than those that are found far away to the poles. And so in the course of the movement of these ocean currents, warm ocean currents from the water bodies around the equator would be made to move towards the poles, either to the northern part of the world or to the southern parts of the world. And so, in so doing, the warm ocean currents helps in increasing the temperature of areas that are found adjacent to the equator. And then, in the same way, because the north and the south poles are characterized by cold conditions, the waters around those areas are also cold. So the movements of the earth could also trigger the movement of water now from the north towards the equator too, and then from the south also towards the equator. So the cold water moving towards the equator also helps in lowering the temperature of areas on its way, whereas the warm water now from the equator helps in raising the temperature of water on its way as it flows. So that is how ocean currents can also help in, can also affect weather and climate. The next factor that we have here is cloud cover. Cloud cover. Now the amount of clouds in the sky could also determine the weather of an area. How much clouds are in the sky could determine the flow of sunlight, solar radiation to the earth's surface, and how less the sun is, how less the clouds are, sorry, in the sky could also determine the flow of solar radiation. Now in the equatorial regions where rainfall is much, you discover that usually the skies are much, are covered much with the clouds, and it gives rise to heavy rainfall or torrential rainfall. Whereas in areas of less rainfall, you will discover that most at times the skies are clear. And so the penetration of solar radiation to the earth's surface is much, because there is no interception. The presence of the clouds in the sky helps in intercepting some of the rays or the energy released by the sun, and so reducing the quantity that gets to the earth's surface. But where the skies are clear, there is a free flow of the solar radiation to the earth's surface, and so it increases the heat of the sun. Now, I hope we all know that the earth is warmed from beneath and not from above. The solar radiation that gets to the surface rises up again, and it moves into the air through convection, conduction radiation, and it helps in increasing the temperature of the environment. But where there are factors that are intercepting it, the environment temperature will be reduced because of such interception. So students, by God's grace, in our next lesson, we shall talk about how the elements of weather and climate can be measured. But for today, we are stopping the lesson here, and I have an assignment for you. You will do the assignment and then send the assignment through my WhatsApp page. The number is here on the board. 08107998160. You are going to distinguish clearly between weather and climate, and then you will explain how atmospheric pressure can be measured. With the aid of a diagram, you will explain to me how atmospheric pressure can be measured. We hope to see you again in the next lesson. Wish you the best. Stay safe and observe all the rules. Thank you so much.